Welcome, everybody. Thank you very much for coming out tonight for our commemoration of World War I, from Civvies to the Trenches. We're very happy to have you and be working with the School of Arts and Communication on this program. We are at this library, and this is one of our library after-hours events. And we do have a couple events coming up next week as well. We have Sustainable Happiness on Wednesday night, which is a talk with Rajiv Vaisya. And that will be upstairs. And then on Friday night, we also have It's Our Client, Our Climate, a Science-Based Forum. So the library does do after-hours events most Fridays. So without further ado, thank you very much. I'll introduce Dr. Bob Taylor, who is our keynote speaker tonight.
Well, good evening, everybody.
Good evening. Good evening.
Good. For the students here, this will be on the final. So many people to thank, especially the wonderful folks here at the Evans Library who let us come here once in a while and do what we'd like to do most, which is talk about history and its impact on the modern world. And it's nice to see so many people out there riding on. And they say there's nothing to do in November. Well, I'm here tonight with a distinguished panel of historians and scholars who are going to look at an experience and an event that most Americans still don't know very much about. It's called the First World War. And right off the bat, some of my students asked me, why did they call it World War I? How did they know? They didn't call World War I World War I during World War I. It was the Great War, the World War, or the War. You didn't have to ask which one. And as it turned out, it was only the first half of what would be almost a century-long conflict. In 1914, when this war broke out, I think Western civilization, in many ways, was its most prosperous and its most confident. And in a few short years, these bastions of Western civilization would create an environment where they would slaughter millions of their own people. Battlefields from France to Russia to Gallipoli near Turkey. Now, when this war broke out, most Americans read about it in their newspapers. And I think I'm probably pretty safe in saying most people would say, thank God we're not in it. Those crazy Europeans, there they go again. Well, it was very difficult for the United States to remain neutral. Our official position was neutrality. We were supposed to be neutral in thought as well as in deed. But that was hard. Aren't Americans and Britons sort of cousins? Sort of. The French made our independence possible and had recently given us a very nice statue to put in New York Harbor, which we appreciated. Now, not everybody in the United States was a lover of Britain and France. If you asked an Irish American their opinion of the British Empire, I think you'd get a warm response. There were many, many Germans in America, German Americans, who did not buy that the entire German people were bloodthirsty Huns who went around raping and pillaging and doing terrible things. One thing that most historians agree on, war is one great big atrocity, and all the folks in it commit atrocities. Well, okay. It's hard to be neutral in thought. It's hard to be neutral economically. The United States is a neutral country who's able to trade with both sides. And that's great. It's wonderful for business. Britain and France needed American food. They needed American industrial products. And they were willing to pay. And of course, when their money began to run low, when they had a cash flow problem, which I know students can appreciate, they started borrowing money from American banks. When we started loaning Britain and France money, were we a neutral power? No. We now had a vested interest in their winning this war, so our banks could get the loans repaid with interest. The President of the United States, of course, is Thomas Woodrow Wilson. He preferred to be called Woodrow Wilson, not Tom Wilson. It sounded too ordinary. a man of high ideals, perhaps naive. It's hard to be neutral about Woodrow Wilson. He wanted the United States to remain neutral. That proved to be impossible. American ships, neutral ships, would be attacked in the ocean by a new weapon called the German U-boat, submarines, which were considered particularly sneaky because they used stealth to destroy their targets without warning. There were folks who thought submarines should warn merchant ships beforehand and let the crews abandon ship before they're torpedoed. And then pick up the survivors. No. Americans are going to be killed. The United States would diplomatically protest. The German response? No, we are fighting a world war here. Eventually, passenger liners would be attacked, the most famous in 1950 in the Lusitania. Large loss of American life. People thundered for something to be done about it. Former President Teddy Roosevelt wanted to declare war immediately, form a new Rough Rider regiment, and go to France personally to defeat the Germans. He didn't get to go. One of his sons did, and he was killed in action there. War wasn't fun for Teddy Roosevelt after that anymore. Well, by 1917, to make a complicated story short, deteriorated to the point where the United States had to do something. And President Woodrow Wilson goes to Congress and asks Congress to declare war on Germany and Germany's allies. And it did. This is back when Congress actually declared war against other countries. 56 members of Congress voted no in 1917. Very interesting, when the United States declared war on Japan in 1941, one member of Congress voted no, which is a tremendous act of courage on her, it was her, a woman on her part. Well, okay, we're in this war. What does that mean? Is it gonna disrupt American life? Are we gonna have to, heaven forbid, send an army to France? But the answer to all of those questions was yes, yes, and yes. Not everybody in America is on board for this war. And it leads to a fundamental question of American democracy. What do you do when the nation is at war and you don't support the war? Can you publicly say you don't support the war? Can you write editorials against it? Can you protest it? Most of us would probably say, well, I think so. Well, not necessarily. There would be, during the First World War, and this has happened in American wars past and frankly present, a curtailment of civil rights. Folks weren't able to say things they wanted to or print things they wanted to. In wartime, World War I was no exception, the First Amendment is put on hold. There's a law called the Sedition Act. It basically put the First Amendment on hold. And you can draw almost a direct line from the Sedition Act to the current Patriot Act. Have Americans' rights been curtailed in the current war on terror? Been to an airport lately? As a TSA agent, one of your new best friends? Exactly. And things are going on we don't know about, and probably it's better that we don't. Well, all right, we've got to deal with dissent. It was very difficult. For example, for German Americans, there would be not only legal ramifications, but at times mob violence. Fear and hatred took over. German Americans would be attacked. If an American of German descent didn't buy enough war bonds, he or she might be beaten to a bloody pulp. Local communities would do things that sound silly, and students always snicker at them, but they were deadly serious at the time. Sauerkraut was renamed Liberty Cabbage. Frankfurters were renamed Liberty Sausages. And in many places, the teaching of the German language was banned, which frankly I've never understood. If you're at war with Germany, knowing the language might be of military use. No. It's a wonder what would have happened if the war would have gone on longer for American civil liberties. And this is something Woodrow Wilson agonized over. He saw no choice. Well, how are we going to fight this war? Well, believe it or not, a huge number of Americans did not want to volunteer to cross the ocean and get to see what the trenches were like on the Somme River or near Verdun. where people were being killed by the hundreds of thousands. So we can't count on volunteers. So what we're going to use is a national draft. Much better than the Civil War version. It's going to be selective service. We create the selective service system, which many people here have probably had some contact with. Even our young folks, I believe you have to be registered for today if you want financial aid, right? You just fill out a form so the government knows where you are, just in case. Now basically, the key word there is select. We scientifically survey the military age population and decide who would be better in the army carrying a rifle or staying home in a rifle factory making rifles or growing food. And this introduced Americans to the concept of the local draft board, where you would go in and you would be physically examined and rated, and decisions would be made on your suitability for service. And there were some folks even then who attempted to dodge the draft. There would even be some draft resistance, usually in rural areas, the hills of Tennessee, hills of northern Alabama, places where people weren't sure where Germany was, but they knew that no Germans had messed with their kin, and until they did that, they had no ambition to go and fight. Eventually, names of people who had been selected by draft boards who didn't report, the names were published in local newspapers, just to help remind you that you have a date with Uncle Sam. Eventually, some 2 million young Americans were inducted into basically the army, and now they have to be trained. That's where we have a problem. During the First World War, the United States was not, repeat, not an arsenal for democracy. Our industrial base was absolutely, totally unprepared for this conflict. There were shortages of everything. And think about it. If we induct 2 million men into the military, does that mean we need 2 million pairs of boots? Now, 2 million shirts, 2 million pairs of socks, that's assuming you wear one pair. And let's not even get into equipment. World War I proved that wearing a steel helmet was very, very good for your health in the trenches. Head wounds went down 75%. So you need one of those. There's a shortage. The U.S. Army had not picked which machine gun it was going to adopt yet. So we had to borrow them from the British and the French. And Professor Ruane and I, once on a tour of the French Army Museum in Paris, saw a model of the worst machine gun ever devised. And of course, this was issued to American troops. These new armored fighting vehicles called tanks, we don't have any of those. We had to borrow them from the French. In fact, some of them were made by the Renault company. And this is, of course, the United States, where we had the Model T, but we had no tanks. The United States did not produce one combat aircraft in World War I. So when Americans went to the Western Front to fly, they had to use borrowed British and French planes. What were the quality of those hand-me-down planes, do you think?
Probably break
down. Oh yeah, the leftovers. Burned out. But what are you gonna do? Beggars cannot be choosers. How do you train these people? Commanding General of the U.S. Army is gonna have to go to France because the British and the French are begging for American troops. There's a guy named John J. Pershing, known as Black Jack, among other things. Had a long military career. In fact, had been promoted from captain to brigadier general in one jump. Those of you who know something about the military know that's a pretty gosh darn good promotion. I think the fact that his wife is married to the daughter of a United States Senator may have played a role there. Kind of interesting, Pershing would later be widowed, his family would die in a terrible fire. And Pershing dated a lot. One of the women he dated was a young woman named Nita Patton, whose brother George S. Patton Jr. was a rare to go army officer who used his sister's relationship with the general to make sure he got to go to France. I know you're shocked. George was absolutely determined to get there and do what he loved to do. Well, Pershing studied American Civil War battles in preparation for taking American troops to France. Why? They didn't have poison gas in the Civil War. They didn't have machine guns or tanks. They had trenches. He was absolutely convinced that the problem in Europe was a lack of enthusiasm among British and French soldiers. What they need are red-blooded American boys with their rifles. We'll do just fine. But when American troops started arriving in France, and actually they were there by July 4th, 1917, first unit, these fellows weren't exactly ready for the trenches. There's one classic story where a French army officer in uniform goes up to a sentry in an American army camp, says, "Excuse me," he spoke English, "excuse me, young man, give me a rifle, please." And the young country boy private gives the French officer his rifle and says, "Would you watch my post for me for a couple minutes? I'm gonna go and have a cigarette." French officer writes, "Americans have no clue. Tray silly." And this would lead to a huge, huge fight. The British and French would say, "Look, we're glad you Americans are here, but you're clueless. Let's take your soldiers and put them in existing British and French units. They can learn from professionals. If you're alive in the trenches in 1917, you're a professional. And flesh out our units, they'll be up to full strength, we can beat the Germans faster. What do you say?" Well, General Pershing asked the question, what do American officers do? In particular, guys like me? "Oh, nothing. Stay in Paris." Pershing, "No. American troops will fight in a separate American army commanded by American officers, or we are going home. Understand?" Fortunately for him, President Wilson backed him up. And he would insist that American troops have at least 3 months training. It often didn't happen, but he tried before they went anywhere near a trench. Initially, Americans would take heavy casualties. War has a pretty steep learning curve. You make mistakes, it's not like doing badly on a test. People get hurt. People get killed. Now, American troops are going to make a huge impact on this struggle. At one point, tens of thousands of Americans were arriving in France every day. And remember, in World War I, we did not have to invade France. There's no D-Day. American troops walked off troop ships down a gangway into cities and port cities. Not to do that. Tremendous battles and tremendous heroes. One of the things that Pershing was unhappy about is that he had been forced to bring a brigade of United States Marines with him to France. Now, things are different now among the services. Once upon a time, the Army and the Marines were like big brother and little brother, and big brother wished that little brother had never been born and would go away. Well, the Marines insisted. But while in France, Pershing ordered a complete news blackout of all American units. No names, no numbers, for security reasons. But this didn't cover the Marine Corps, because they're technically part of the Navy. So reporters, when they needed a story, went. In World War I, Marines got great press. And how do you think this made soldiers feel? There'd be tremendous resentment. In fact, later on, a World War I veteran named Harry Truman expressed his displeasure with the PR that the Marines got. They earned it. Actually, at the Battle of Belleau Wood, the modern Marine Corps was created. That's really where they became the Marines, the devil dogs of the Belleau Wood. By 1918, there is a separate large American army with an air force, with a tank force that is going to charge into the German lines. One of the longest and bloodiest battles ever fought in American history was in September and October 1918, called the Meuse-Argonne. And probably most of the people in this room never heard of it, unless you're World War I buff. Heavy casualties. The Germans had defended, had years to put up defensive lines. There was an American cemetery there now, and there are 14,000 graves of Americans killed in World War I there alone. Of course, we know the story. November 1918, the Germans say, "We're done. We'd like an armistice, please, on the 11th day of the 11th month at the 11th hour. Anybody here remember growing up on that day when it was still called Armistice Day? There'd be a moment of silence or fire whistles would blow. Armistice Day is about the ending of the First World War. Then it sort of morphed into Veterans Day, which is for all veterans who clearly deserve it, but World War I got covered up. It's kind of amazing. The United States, a country that no one took seriously militarily, had created a large modern army, shipped it to France, trained it, somehow equipped it, took it into battle against the world champion Germans, and beat them. Something to be proud of. Now, the reason we need to remember this conflict is its aftershocks. In a way, it's like an earthquake. We're still feeling the aftershocks. And I'll go through them very briefly because there are other folks here that need to speak. The generation that fought World War I, when they came home, there was a lot of disillusionment. People were already thinking this war was a mistake. You guys who went, you were suckers. In fact, you should have dodged the draft. That was foolish. And you have a lost generation, particularly writers who were just embittered by their experience. Many of whom are talked about in our literature classes here. What were veterans' benefits like for World War I veterans? Microscopic. You got a discharge, maybe a handshake, and that's it. The government would later welch of a promise to pay World War I veterans a bonus in about 1932. It's no accident that World War II veterans would have a tremendous benefit package called the GI Bill to make up for that disgrace. The mood in the country, forgive me, America first. Forget the rest of the world. We've been there, done that. We're not the world's policemen. We're not cleaning up any more European or Asian messes. Isolationism. And of course, we have the luxury of looking back and knowing what a big mistake that was. World War I led to the rise of communism in Russia, which is going to, of course, later be a driving force in the whole 20th, most of the 20th century. World War I is going to cause the rise of fascism in Italy and, of course, Germany. Although Hitler was and Benito Mussolini were World War I veterans. The Middle East. The problems of the Middle East today can be traced directly back to the First World War. Iraq and Kuwait were created by the British Foreign Office with somebody with a pencil who didn't bother to ask the people there about whether these were viable countries or not. And of course, the seeds of a second greater conflict would be in the ground and about to germinate barely before the guns of World War I came to an end. Now, ladies and gentlemen, as of now, as far as I know, there are no longer any living American World War I veterans. The very last one died, I believe, a few years ago. So the American Expeditionary Force that went to France is all present and accounted for. We ignore the lessons of their experience and their valor, I think, at our own peril as people. So it's fitting and proper that we remember what happened 100 years ago and what this war meant for a generation of Americans. Now, I want to pause and bring up the real stars of the evening, the rest of our distinguished panel. And the first will be Dr. Matt Ruane, a man who needs no introduction, so I will give him one. He's an assistant professor of history and our World War I scholar. Dr. Ruane.
So Dr. Taylor sort of set us off, and I'm actually going to go back a little bit here and talk about what's called the Black Tom explosion in New Jersey on the 30th of July, 1916. This explosion took place in Jersey City, New Jersey, not too far from where I grew up, and actually my first summer job was working as a meter reader for the power company in Jersey City, New Jersey. So I know a little bit about it. This is sabotage on American ammunition supplies by German agents to prevent the material to be used in the Allies in World War I. And the investigations into the attack will eventually reveal that it was a terrorist incident. And as most historians will agree, this is the very precise language I'm using here, the first major terrorist attack on US soil by a foreign power. Not the biggest, but the first. And it is likely the result of German spy ring work in the United States. Now, the term Black Tom Island comes from an island in New York Harbor, not far from Liberty Island. And in this picture, I know it might be a little bit to see, this is 1912, with the Statue of Liberty in the front. But that spit of land on your right, sticking out, is Black Tom Island. Okay. I'll put it a little easier to understand. There's Black Tom Island. And if you go a little bit to the south and east of that, you will reach, or east of that and towards the bottom of the screen, you will reach Liberty Island. This map doesn't go any further than that. The island in 1880 becomes a causeway, links from the mainland to the island by the railway, by the Lehigh Valley Railway Company. And it was built to the mainland to be used as a shipping depot. Sometime between 1905 and 1916, the records are sort of missing for this, the Lehigh Valley Railroad Company, which owned the island and causeway, expanded the island with landfill, resulting in the addition of the entire area being incorporated into Jersey City limits. You can see on the map there where the channel is, but that's also where the New York, New Jersey shoreline is, at least in this part. The area contained a mile-long pier that housed the depot, as well as the warehouses of the National Dock and Storage Company. Black Tom was a major munitions depot for materials manufactured in the Northeast. In 1916, it was the hub of a massive American munitions industry where 75% of all ammunition and armaments meant for Europe were shipped from within 5 miles of New York City, much of it from this pier. Prior to a 1915 blockade by the Central Powers, by the Royal British Royal Navy, American industries were free to sell their materials to any buyer, but by the time the Allies, by this time in 1916, the Allies were the only possible customers, Britain, France, and Russia. It was reported that on the night of the attack, 2 million pounds of ammunition were being stored at the depot in freight cars, including 100,000 pounds. Or for those of you trying to figure that out, a more general number, 50 tons of TNT on Johnson Barge number 17. All of this was awaiting shipment to Britain, France, and in this particular case, as I'll talk about a little later on, it is believed from records that this was all meant for Russia. Along with the barge were 69 railroad freight cars carrying more than 1,000 tons of ammunition, as I talked, pounds. Of ammunition all waiting to go. It was an obvious tempting target for the Germans. After midnight on the 30th of July 1916, a series of small fires were found on the pier. Some guards fled. They obviously knew what would happen if these fires spread. Others attempted to fight the fires before they eventually called the Jersey City Fire Department. At 2:08 a.m., the first and the biggest of the explosions took place. Shrapnel from the explosion traveled long distances, some lodging in the clock tower of the Jersey Journal newspaper building in Journal Square, over a mile away. It stopped the clock at 2:12 a.m., and the clock on the tower is still stopped to this day at 2:12 a.m. on the side facing Black Tom Harbor. Other pieces lodged in the Statue of Liberty, including in the arm and the torch. The explosion was the equivalent, we believe, of an earthquake measuring between 5 and 5.5 on the Richter scale. It was felt as far away as Philadelphia, about 65 miles away from where the explosion took place. Windows as far as 25 miles away were destroyed, including thousands of huge plate glass windows in lower Manhattan. Some window panes in Times Square were completely shattered. The outer wall of Jersey City's City Hall was cracked, and the Brooklyn Bridge was shaking. People as far away as Maryland were awoken by what they thought was an earthquake happening in their neighborhood. Peter Rossetta, the captain of a flat-bottom barge in the harbor, was in his cabin watching the fire on Black Tom with two other men. He wrote, quote, "When the explosion came, it seemed as if it had come from above. Zoomf, like a Zeppelin bomb," he told a reporter from the New York Times. "There were five or six other lighters alongside mine at the dock, and the tug was just coming up to drag us away. I don't know what became of the tug or the other lighters. It looked like they all went up in the air." Firefighters on the scene could do little as bullets and shrapnel continued to fly through the air. Doctors and nurses tried their best to deal with the wounded. Smaller explosions continued to occur for hours after the initial blast. Immigrants on Ellis Island, which is just up about 2 miles from Black Tom Island, had to be brought to New York City to be taken for their safety away from the processing halls of Ellis Island where they were overnight. There was no place to bring them in New York City, so they piled them into Castle Clinton, which by then was not really being used for very much. It had been an aquarium for a short while, but a pile of immigrants, about 2,000 immigrants into Castle Clinton. Reports vary, but we believe that only 10 people were killed during this explosion, but the numbers of injured were in the hundreds. The numbers go between 7 and 10. The one real tragedy was a baby in New York City who was bounced out of his crib by the explosion and fell 5 stories to his death on plate glass that had fallen out of nearby windows on the first floor. So this is some of the aftermath. We'll show you some of these images here for things. There's a barge still on fire. There are no actual images of the explosion itself. It's at night. Photography was not going to allow photography at that point. This is part of the dockyard. This is the next day. Buildings are destroyed. That's that same sort of picture, just a different angle. That is an entire 4-story building that's gone. This is looking overhead at the number of buildings all at the far end that are completely destroyed. I apologize for this picture. It's fairly big, but the magnification is not very good. This one's much better. This is actually from the Associated Press a day later. That is a fire wagon from the Jersey City Fire Department. And in the background, you can see the entire devastation of the warehouses and other structures that were on the docks here. This is even a better picture of the other one we saw from up above, so you can see all the buildings massively destroyed. This is New York City. New York City policemen dealing with plate glass windows that had fallen out of the building, and those are U.S. Army recruits who were called from the National Guard Armory in New York City, who were sent out to make sure there was no looting the following day. I'll come back to those guys in a second. Now, property damage was estimated at $20 million in 1916 dollars. Put that in today's money, about $500 million, half a billion dollars of property damage. The Black Tom complex was a charred ruin. 13 warehouses were leveled, 6 piers were destroyed, and hundreds of railroad cars and barges were ruined. The damage to the Statue of Liberty was valued at $100,000, for about $2.5 million today, including shrapnel in the skirts that are still there, was there at least till 1967 when the statue was first refurbished. The torch itself, which was a very popular attraction from 1888 until 1915, used to be able to go up through a set of spiral staircases inside the arm out to the balcony around the torch, and it was the ideal place to see. Since the Black Tom explosion, the arm has been closed off to all but National Park Service employees. It's too dangerous to climb up the arm. The shrapnel tore so much through the interior structure that the arm can only support itself and 500 pounds of additional weight at any given time. And they can't fix it without having the arm fall off, and I don't think we want the Statue of Liberty to be without an arm. Three railroad company officials were immediately arrested by Jersey City police officials and charged with manslaughter. They were believed that they had been responsible for setting a fire on two freight cars that started all of this. Two guards were also arrested when other guards said that they were out lighting smudge pots, small little pots filled with oil that let out black smoke, and that it was the smudge pots that started the fire. If you grew up in New Jersey and you know anything about July, you know there are these things called not Florida mosquitoes, but New Jersey mosquitoes that will suck the blood out of you in half a second. So the smudge pots were out there to keep away mosquitoes. However, it became very clear that the blast had not been an accident and that the men already arrested were innocent. So eventually, there's an investigation in 1916, in the fall of 1916, about who's responsible for this. And the people who become the main investigators for this are the New York City Police Department's bomb squad. I'll talk a little bit more about them in a moment. There is no Federal Bureau of Investigation. There's no FBI. There are very few people who have any power to investigate anywhere. And the New York City Bomb Department, the detectives of the bomb squad, were already investigating other activities that German spies have already been up to. Well, what they determined is that these two men are ultimately responsible for what happened here. On the left is Count Johann von Bernstorff. He is the German ambassador to the United States. He had arrived in 1914 with a number of intelligence operatives as well as funds meant to support the German war effort. There's only one problem. As you can see, this man, Johann von Bernstorff, does not look like he's a spy, because he's not. He brings this man, with the help of the German High Command, Captain Franz von Ritterlin, who arrives in April 1917. Now, von Ritterlin is not a spy himself, though he will become very quickly an able spy. He arrives in April 1917. He spoke excellent English. And from pre-war connections, he had intimate connections with Manhattan High Society, especially the social and cultural world. Though originally not trained as a spy, von Ritterlin becomes one, and he organized a network of operatives in the United States drawn from the crew and officers of more than 80 German vessels that had been impounded in New York Harbor once the war had begun. It was von Ritterlin who designed, with the help of a German-American chemist, so-called pencil bombs. These pencil bombs are cigar-shaped charges filled with acids placed in copper chambers. The acids would ultimately eat their way through the copper and mingle, creating intense, very silent flames. If designed and placed properly, a pencil bomb could be timed to detonate days later while ships and their cargo were at sea. And that's what von Ritterlin did at first, was that men were smuggling these items on leaving from New York Harbor and out in the middle of the ocean, anywhere between 4 and 7 days, and most of the way across the ocean, these pencil bombs went off and exploded the cargoes. In some cases, the ship being at first by the British, that it was German submarines. Von Ritterlin is believed to have arranged for attacks on approximately 36 ships, destroying millions of dollars worth of cargo. In many cases, he was aided by, as Dr. Taylor hinted at, disgruntled Irish dock workers who thought anything they could do to screw the British would be a good thing, even if it meant taking German money. There was also other workers and so on, German Americans, who were convinced or bribed to participate in this, but this is a fairly huge network of people, and it's being run not out of the German embassy in Washington, D.C., because that's illegal. It's being run out of a German consulate in Baltimore. Now, U.S. officials become worried at the number of mysterious explosions at sea, but there's no National Intelligence Service, as I said, beyond a small number of military operatives in the Army and Navy, Army Intelligence and Navy Intelligence, and a few diplomats who were basically home-trained spies. More remarkably, and I learned this only today by perusing a CIA report on this that was done, that there was no federal statute that made espionage and sabotage a crime. That's very different today. German agents were guilty of planting bombs and of passport fraud. Passport fraud is what they could be arrested on. But no federal agency had either the power or the resources or manpower to follow any lead hinting at a foreign directed conspiracy. Only a few Secret Service agents were, after the Lusitania sinking in 1915, ordered to keep an eye on German diplomats. Von Ritalin, these are bombs that would be put in various different spots and elsewhere, mostly homemade bombs. Von Ritalin was eventually captured by British intelligence when he had been given a series of orders by German intelligence to come back in the fall of 1915 to receive new orders and to report about how successful his bombing campaign is to this point. Germans, as we'll find out later on, German intelligence was deciphered by the British. They knew exactly where he was going to be in the English Channel, and a British naval vessel came beside this neutral vessel, came on board and arrested Van Ritalin. Ritalin quickly submitted to British questioning. You can figure out why that was. Torture was most likely used. And after Van Ritalin's arrest, the saboteurs began to move from directly placing bombs on ships to land-based espionage. It became apparent that Von Ritalin had sort of ratted out his system. In fact, German-speaking detectives of the New York City bomb squad had been sent out into the bars and taverns of Lower Manhattan to begin as disgruntled German agents and sailors to get German sailors or German-speaking sailors to give up this evidence that they had already been planting bombs. And so the spring of 1916, the bombing campaign on ships had largely come to an end because it had been disrupted by the New York City bomb squad. A modern CIA report says that even despite everything that was known at the time and reports elsewhere, we don't know how effective the German saboteur ring was, how large it was, how many members there were, nor how effective the New York Police Department was at disrupting its efforts, because obviously, they continued. This man, Inspector Tunney, of the New York City Bomb Squad Detective, is sort of at the heart of this story. There's actually a more recent book I'll tell you at the very end that is from his viewpoint from the New York City Bomb Squad about what's going on. And he's really the one who begins to uncover what happened at Black Tom. With generous cash bribes, Von Ritalin and his successors had little problem gaining access to peers, which is how a man named Michael Kristof, a Slovak immigrant living in Bayonne, New Jersey, is believed to have gotten into the Black Tom munitions works in July of 1916. Now, Kristof was not a worker at the Black Tom yards, but he knew people who were there. He socialized with people in the taverns of Jersey City and Bayonne. His landlady said he often came back late at night drunk and smelling of oil and gunpowder, but no one ever put two and two together. He also had two friends or allies, we believe, a man named Lothar Witzke and Kurt Jahnke, two German agents. And the three men obviously gained access to the Black Tom facility and set the incendiary devices that caused the explosion. This only comes out in 1918, after it took years of investigation by New York City police officials and eventually by naval intelligence to piece together the area here. After the war's end in 1919, the Lehigh Valley Company sought damages against Germany under the Treaty of Berlin with the German-American Mixed Claims Commission. The commission eventually, after years of evidence and years of proof, eventually the commission decides on January 1939 that Imperial Germany owed the Lehigh Valley Railroad Company the sum of $50 million. They were responsible. They ordered damages. But a man with a little bristled mustache said, no, we were going to fight this. And so eventually, the commission meets again after World War II. And in 1953, the sum is again agreed on, $50 million, and the German government made its last payment on January 1, 1979. Now, the Lehigh Company did go out afterwards. US Navy and Army people did go out in 1916 and 1917, sending divers. Two divers will die from bombs that went off under the ocean, under the water. But they went out and would recover much of this ammunition. You can see here, Ellis Island's in the background, so you can see how close it is for where they were covering some of these shells and crates of shells. And in fact, I think this is more impressive. This is all shells. The only thing missing are the fuses on the top. Right? Still deadly, loaded with powder, but there's no explosive fuse on the top. After the Black months later, there was a massive explosion at the Hercules Powder Company in Pennsylvania, killing more than 100 workers, mostly women and children. The Canadian car and foundry explosion in Kingsland, New Jersey, about 10 miles away from the Black Tom site in January 1917, was further signs of sabotage taking place still as the war went along. It was estimated that more than 43 factories were attacked prior to the spring of 1917. While this is an important number of targets struck by the saboteurs, the overall effect, honestly, is it did very little to the huge American economy. Cost estimates by the CIA in 2007 placed estimates at $150 million 1916 dollars, about $1.5 billion today. What the attacks do, while not hampering the war effort, is that they do poison US public opinion against Germany with the final straw, as we're going to hear soon, coming from the Zimmermann telegram and its effects. In April 1917, after the declaration of war, the Attorney General authorized the agents of his small Bureau of Investigation to begin actively investigating the espionage of Germans in the country. A few weeks later, Congress would pass the Espionage Act and subsequently the Sabotage Act, empowering the now 400 agents of the Bureau of Investigation to root out German agents in the United States. One of the young attorneys working for the Justice Department who joins in with the Bureau of Investigation is the future director of the FBI, J. Edgar Hoover. The US Army Department, with the assistance of British spies to actually train American military spies, decided that the easiest way to create its spy agency at home was to basically hire every single member of the New York Police Department's bomb squad and make them army military contractors spies. And Tunney will actually go on to become a captain in the Army Intelligence Bureau during the war. Once the US entered into the war, rather miraculously, the attacks of sabotage and terrorism virtually stopped for two reasons. One reason is that Germany decided at this point it really wasn't worth it anymore. And at the second point, as Dr. Taylor hinted at, the fear of Germans and German Americans were so much in this country, people were so vigilant, that any sign that someone who was German or German American acting strangely suddenly was reported to authorities and people were arrested. Now, Black Tom Island today can be visited. It's part of Liberty State Park. All of the land that we saw for the pier has all been filled in. There's actually a housing development in the area today. The park consists of former industrial railroad lands that have all been, as I just said, turned into apartment complexes and very expensive townhouses. The view of New York City is quite impressive. There's a plaque that marks the spot, but I want to leave it with this. This was the ultimate biggest thing about the Black Tom explosion. And for those of you in the back who can't read this, it says, "The lessons to America are clear as day. We must not again be caught napping with no adequate national intelligence organization. The several federal bureaus should be welded into one, and that one should be eternally and comprehensively vigilant. Arthur Woods, Police Commissioner of New York, 1919. This is the creation, the Black Tom explosion in its heart is the creation today of the domestic intelligence agencies that we have and the domestic intelligence state that we have to root out terrorism and so on in the United States, traces to this." If you're interested in more of this, my advice is to look for the most recent book on this subject by a man named Howard Blum, B-L-U-M. It's called Dark Invasion 1915, Germany's Secret War and the Hunt for the First Terrorist Cell in America. And it was released by Harper in 2014. It's not a very thick book, about 300 pages. Thank you.
Well, thank you, Dr. Ruane. One of the issues that was throbbing through American life in the early years of the 20th century was the fact that America was a biracial society. African Americans, white Americans. America was a strictly segregated society. And when the war came along, there were some questions, if we are fighting for freedom and democracy, does that mean for everyone? How does that play out? I think it's very interesting that around the time of the First World War, the first full-length motion picture was released, called Birth of a Nation, in glorious black and white. President Woodrow Wilson, a history PhD himself, had it screened at the White House and said the film was history written with lightning. And if you've ever seen Birth of a Nation, you know that the heroes who ride in at the end to save the day are members of the Ku Klux Klan. Very interesting. Now, Dr. Jacob Ivey is going to take a look at race and the American war effort.
No,
Dr. Allen. Well, Dr. Allen, who is going to be talking to us about the Zimmerman telegram, as pointed out, that the Germans were not above using covert operations in their attempt to win this war. Remember, we're talking about national survival here. And the Zimmerman telegram is a story of intelligence gathering, intelligence interpretation, and the origins of high tech in these areas. In war, technology is like peanut butter and jelly. It absolutely goes together. I apologize, I was just so excited about race. I wanted to go to that, but we need to hear about the Zimmerman telegraph, so without any further ado, Professor Allen.
How many people are familiar with the term the Zimmerman telegram? A few people here, anyone read the book by Barbara Tuchman? Okay, I'm gonna talk a little about that. But that book was written a long time ago, and so a lot of new information has come out about this. So I'll go through it. So suppose people have them, that's good, that'll make it easier to go through. So we talked about this, another term for the war was the war to end all wars. Began in Europe in July 28, 1914. The Allied side, Russia, France, United Kingdom, Central Powers, Germany, and Austria, Hungary. And the United States, as Dr. Taylor said, remained neutral during that time. In 1914, the British Navy blockaded Germany, and in 1915, they started unrestricted warfare with U-boats. Now, originally, in some cases, the U-boats actually would surface, approach a ship on the surface, tell them, we're gonna sink you, you might as well go ahead and get in your boats and get away. But they ran into two problems with that. One is that the ships they were attacking would sometimes fight back. They didn't like that, so they stopped that. Another problem was, if they're out in the middle of the ocean and they sink the ship, there's only one place to take the survivors, that's on the U-boat. If you've ever seen a World War I era U-boat, it's not a very big boat. You can't take hundreds of survivors, you can't even take dozens of survivors. So the skippers of this U-boats just decided to go ahead, sink the ships, leave, don't say anything, don't warn them about it. And the unrestricted warfare then meant they would attack anything that they thought, well, anything that wasn't German, they would attack anything that they found at sea. In 1915, the Lusitania was sunk off the coast of Ireland. 128 US citizens were killed. How many people here were told the Lusitania sinking was the cause of getting into World War I? I used to say this in school a long time ago. And it was a factor, definitely. But you'll notice the date, 1915, you'll see, as Dr. Taylor said, we don't get into the war until 1917. So it wasn't a direct result, but it was part of that buildup. At the time, there was a tremendous amount of resistance, and so the United States still stayed out of the war. In that case, also, technology fairly limited. A ship like the Lusitania would just take off, sail across the ocean. It was fast. RMS stood for Royal Mail Ship. The British sent their mail by these ships because they could cross the ocean in a few days, and so they thought, no problem, you don't need to worry about submarines because we're faster than they are. And they were. Submarines could not catch a ship like the Lusitania. But if you're crossing the Atlantic and you're going to Dublin, or you're going to Bristol, or you're going to Liverpool, there's really only one way to go. You cross the Atlantic and you go right around the southern coast of Ireland. So all you have to do is wait for them. So this changed the tactics of taking ships across the ocean as well. So President Wilson, as Dr. Taylor said, tried to avoid getting the United States involved in the war. In fact, when he's reelected, his reelection was based on the idea that he kept us out of the war. War had been going on for about 2 years now in Europe, and we didn't want to be involved in that. So the U.S. continued to stay out of the war. But then something happened that kind of was the tipping point. British intelligence intercepted a telegram from German Foreign Minister Arthur Zimmermann to the German ambassador to Mexico. This telegram had a message in it for the German ambassador to convey to the president of Mexico. Now, at this time, Mexico is not really happy with the United States because there have been some interactions there, some battles along the Veracruz, a lot of other things happening, where the United States and Mexico were not on good terms. So it started off with inform the Mexican president that war with the United States is certain. This is the German government saying war with the United States is certain. If Mexico joins Germany and Japan against the United States, Germany will give financial support to Mexico, and Mexico can take back Texas, New Mexico, and Arizona. This was the offer. And so Mexican government had to consider this, and they thought about it for a little bit. But as I'll say in a minute, they didn't do much with it. This is an example. This is actually is the Zimmermann telegram. If you can see, it is a series of numbers, 4 and 5-digit numbers. A few of them are 3-digit numbers. The idea is that each of these code numbers represents a word or a character in the message. The code book says 3758 equals this word, etc. Of course, it's all in German, so you also have to go to translate from German in this case. This kind of encoding had been used by them. How many people are familiar with Lord Nelson's message to his ships? England expects that every man will do his duty. Anyone familiar with that? It was in 1805. It was done by signal flags in that case, because you didn't have telegrams. So Nelson flew signal flags up on the ship, and the other ships in his navy, there were 27 ships total, they could see that, they could read that, they could convey the message. It was supposed to encourage the troops. You're gonna go die for England, basically. So this is part of the translation. This was what the cryptographers were doing. They were looking at each of the numbers, they were then figuring out what word it represented or what phrase. And so they translated it. You can see Mexico, Texas, New Mexico, and Arizona is spelled out because there wasn't a word in the book for Arizona, but there were numbers in there that represented the characters, A-R-I-Z-O-N-A. So this is what they were able to decipher from this. So the cryptographers were able to figure out what was in this message. When they did it at first, there were gaps. They weren't able to figure out all of the words. They got enough to see what was happening. And so then they did a bit more work, they were able to do a bit more investigation, I'll talk about it in a few minutes, and they were able to find out this was what the German government was offering in Mexico. If you'll join us, if you'll attack the United States, we'll let you have some money, we'll let you have Texas, New Mexico, and Arizona. Why would they do that? Well, they would do that because they wanted the United States to be distracted. So how did they intercept a coded message that went from Germany to Mexico? This is by telegraph cable, not by radio. Not by letter. This is something that would be sent, an encoded message sent under the ocean from Germany to Mexico. So I think this is the fun part for me because I'm a technology guy. When the war began, the British Navy said, hey, we want to be able to limit what Germany can do. We want to limit their communications with the rest of the world. So they went out and cut most of the cables. They actually sent out ships that dredged up the German cables and cut them off in a couple of places and dropped what was left back in the ocean. They planned it, and they knew where the cables were. They'd already investigated that. The ships actually were already ready to go when the war began. And they left a few cables left, uncut. Those were the cables to the neutral countries. Sweden and the United States at that time were neutral in the war, and what they were doing is acting as brokers. So if you wanted to communicate between Germany and other countries, you'd have to go through Germany, through Sweden, or through the United States. Now, you think, why would the United States? Wilson really wanted to stay as neutral as he could, and so he wanted to allow negotiations to go on between the United States and Germany. So if he didn't allow them to send messages over the U.S. cables, then they wouldn't be able to communicate. Because the only way to communicate at that time was by telegraph cables. The German government didn't think that their diplomatic code was broken. They thought it was safe. They thought they could write messages to anybody at any time. So they actually used the U.S. cable to send the message to the German ambassador in Washington. Because the cable went from Berlin to Washington. They sent it to Washington, he then recoded it, or he had his people recode it and send it down to Mexico to give to the other. So that's how confident they were that no one knew what their code was, that no one was able to break this. On the other hand, the British had planned this. The cable they left uncut crossed England. It went to a relay station on the south coast of England where the signal was boosted before it crossed the ocean. And so the cable actually came up out of the English Channel, across the shore, into a little building. It was retransmitted out the other side. And so, well, it makes it pretty easy for British intelligence to sit there and copy all the messages going through. Now, all they're copying is the coded messages, they're copying the numbers, but they can copy everything going through. And so they're recording all these messages. So now all they need is to know, what is the code? Well, they have been capturing bits and pieces of code for a long time. And also, if you send enough messages with the same code, eventually somebody can figure it out because they have lots and lots of information. And so they can try different combinations until they find words and phrases. And so that's what they were able to do. There were gaps because there were some words and phrases they hadn't seen before or hadn't seen very much of, but they were able to figure out what was happening. So they were able to decode all these messages, and it is to the point where they could tell what they were talking about. So since they had some examples, some pieces of German code books, and in those days, code books were not used for a day or two. Code books were used for years. Because the problem is, if you're going to send messages from Berlin to Washington, you've got to send a copy of the code book to Washington. And if it's a time of war, you can't just count on doing that once a week. So you're going to send it and you're going to keep using it until you know it's broken. You're not going to change it frequently. And so these code books were used not just to Washington, but also to Central America, to South America, to Africa, to Asia. Any messages that the diplomatic department was sending, they were using the same code book. So you could get bits and pieces and put them together. This was being done by a department of British Naval Intelligence called Room 40. British loved to name their departments after the building or the room that they would have. There were a lot of those. In this case, Room 40 was just a number of cryptographers and other experts who worked on breaking these signals, breaking these cables and things like this. This grew into, well, eventually it grew into what's now, what is it? GHQ, yeah, which is the British Cryptographic Intelligence, like our NSA. This was the beginning of that, as they began to do this through World War I, and then through World War II, they did more of it. So this really was some of the very early work. And it was led by one particular British officer, Captain Hall, who was involved in trying to push this forward. He was also involved in a little bit of politics with it. He had to deal with the fact that, so they're decrypting the German messages crossing over England on the US cable that goes from Berlin to Washington. What other messages are crossing from Berlin to Washington? Messages to the United States between the American ambassador and Washington. Were they listening to those? Were they decrypting those? Yes. They could read them almost as fast as the ambassadors in Washington could. And so consequently, he had a problem. He needs to tell the American government that they have found this message because this is really serious. Plus, it also may help them get America into the war. But he doesn't want Germany to know that they're reading the German codes. And he also doesn't want America to know that they're reading the American codes. So they played a little game. They played a number of little games. The Americans also had the problem that when they got this message, they had to be able to convince people that it wasn't fake. They had to be able to convince people that it wasn't something the British had manufactured to try to get America into the war. So they wanted the US to know about it. They gave a copy to the US ambassador immediately, and they gave him a copy of the coded message and the decryption information so he could look at that himself and see. But that's a bit of a careful about how you put that out. You don't want the German, you certainly can't put that in the newspaper. You don't want the German government to know that you have the coded and decoded messages as well. So they created a cover story that basically, they made it look like British agents in Mexico had gotten the message after it got to Mexico. Actually, they had several cover stories. Another one was that they had decrypted a copy of it because it had been re-encoded in Washington to send to Mexico. So they made it look like maybe the code from Washington to Mexico was the one they broke, not the one from Berlin to Washington. They played a lot of different games. He really came up with a lot of different ways to try to trick everybody into doing this. End result, it worked, because the German government still didn't believe that their code had been broken. They still believed it was okay. In fact, they so much were confident that their code hadn't been broken, they figured it had to have been stolen or given by a German worker in the embassy. So they launched an investigation, and they spent months trying to find out who it was in the embassy who did this. And they even issued a big report that said, since we know that the British haven't broken our code, the Americans haven't either, well, he wasn't the British, he was the American. So if you know the Americans haven't broken our code, then it must have been done by someone in the building, and here's who we investigated, we checked these people, we checked those people, and we think it must have been because someone bribed the telegraph company and got it that way, or someone was, or there's a traitor in the embassy that maybe was the one who revealed it. They never suspected, which, if they didn't suspect it was broken, what did they do? They continued to send messages using the same code. The British continued to decrypt them. The British continued to monitor everything that they were doing. So this made it easier for the British to know what the Germans were going to do in regards to the US and anything in North America, really. At one point, for instance, they decrypted messages saying that the German government, the German ships in the ports should take all of their things out of the ships and make sure the ships couldn't be captured so that they might be reused by somebody else. So in that case, they're seeing all these different messages telling them, sounds like the Germans are getting ready for war here. They're saying it's war's coming, they're getting their ships ready for war. There's a lot going on there. And so this meant that the British government had a better one than anybody else, and they revealed what they could, but they had to be careful with how much they give away. So why did Germany take this risk? Well, for one thing, as I said, they believed that no one would know what they're doing. They wanted to divert the United States from war in Europe because they wanted to stop shipping supplies to the UK. They also thought that if they were able to get Mexico and the United States to fight, then that would keep the United States out of the war and it would let them defeat Britain and France, or at least do enough damage to them that if the United States got in the war, it wouldn't be successful. They also were affected greatly by the British blockade. The British were blockading German ports. They were able to choke off supplies, weapons, and food, and it was actually affecting tens of thousands of people in Germany who were not getting enough food because there was no way to do this. Russia wasn't letting it come from the east. They weren't getting it from the south. They weren't getting it from France, and so ships were about the only way they could get it. Sweden and Scandinavia was neutral, so this was really causing a problem for them. So they basically thought they had nothing to lose. Another factor in this was that Arthur Zimmermann, the German foreign minister, fancied himself as quite a spy, quite an espionage agent. And so he had done things before. He decided that he could manipulate all of this and make all of this work. So he convinced them to go ahead and go with this idea. It wasn't really his idea. It was something that came up from one of the staff. But he thought it was a great idea that he would be able to help Germany by doing this. And so that was another reason for doing that. So what did Mexico do? They thought about it, but not for very long, because they had a military commission look into this, and they said, we can't defeat the United States. We're just gonna end up losing. It's gonna hurt us. Plus, we really don't trust that Germany's gonna give us the money and the supplies they promised us, so we're gonna be on our own. We're not gonna do very well. And even if we win, we're gonna have to try to control Texas, Arizona, and New Mexico. That didn't work real well for us about 50 or 60 years earlier, so maybe that's not a good idea. Those people know how to take care of themselves. So they decided this was a bad idea. They told the German president, the Mexican president, he said, no way we're getting involved in this. There's also a political reason. South American countries, particularly Argentina, Brazil, and Colombia, all wanted to stay out of the war. They didn't want to get involved in this. And so they pressured Mexico. They did not want war to get started on South America or Central America. So they put some pressure on Mexico as well. So what did the United States do? Well, Wilson actually released the encrypted message to the Associated Press and was published in newspapers. And it stirred up quite a bit of controversy, but we're talking February 1917, and, well, entry into the war was still unpopular. There was still quite a bit of anti-British sentiment, anti-Mexican sentiment, and there was anti-German sentiment, but there also was quite a bit of doubt about whether we should get involved in this war in Europe. And so there also was a lot of doubt about whether or not this was a true story. They really thought the British had fabricated this to bring us in. They couldn't see any reason why the Germans would have incited Mexico to attack the United States. Didn't make sense. So for a while there, they're kind of ambivalent about this, not much going on. And then March 29th, 1917, Zimmermann publicly admitted he had done this. He said, yeah, we tried to get Mexico to attack the United States. Why would he do this? He really thought that he was going to be able to control this situation. He really thought he'd be able to use this to his advantage in keeping things going. And so that changed things a lot. March 29, 1917, by April 6th, we're at war. It has completely turned around things. The U-boat attacks on American ships, that all had already raised a lot of concern. And then with this, this now is proof that Germany is trying to attack the United States. Let's go ahead and attack them first. And so consequently, the United States Congress, I think it was April 2nd or something like that, that Wilson went ahead and asked, and it took only a few days for Congress to go ahead and declare war, and they were at war already, as you mentioned, by middle of 1917. So if you're interested in learning more about this, there are several books out there. Barbara Tuchman's book from 1958 contained a lot of the information, but she was restricted in what she knew and what she had access to. A lot of the German records were not available at that time, and also she didn't speak read German, so she really didn't have access to those. And there was also a lot of disinformation still going around from Captain Hall, who had run the cryptographic office. He had tried so hard to tell people the British weren't involved in this, and the British didn't use the U.S. cable. We are not listening to the U.S. code. We're not watching the U.S. cables go by. We got it from Sweden. We got it from somebody else. He really kept repeating that, even in his autobiography. So she was affected by that because she didn't have anything else to prove that. There was a short article in a cryptographic quarterly by an officer who works for the National Security Agency, name unrevealed. If you look at this document, which is available online, if you look at this document, there's a lot of stamps all over it. Things are highlighted or redacted. But this was a cryptographer looking at the cryptographic part of it, studying that part. But a newer entry, then a newer report on this, the Zimmerman Telegram, Intelligence Diplomacy, and America's Entry into World War I, this did get access to a lot of this information that wasn't available before. And so this provided proof, for instance, that it was the U.S. cable that was used. This also looked into the German archives and found proof there of why Germany was doing it and what their goals were, what they were trying to do. So that's some other information about it. And I've got one more slide here. Just this is the English translation of, and you can see they're saying, we shall make war together and together make peace. We'll give financial support, and it's understood that Mexico will reconquer her lost territory. They also wanted to get Japan involved in this. So they wanted the president of Mexico to talk to Japan and see if Japan would come into it, because Japan and Germany weren't getting along very well at that time. So yeah, this did definitely give enough impetus to the pro-war movement in that to go ahead and get Congress to approve it. Still not everybody agreed with it, but it was enough to turn the tide and bring it in there. So that's it.
Thank you very, very much. Wow. Countries listening into other countries' secret communications and leaking them to the press. How things have changed. Anyway, now we're going to learn something about race in the First World War with Dr. Jacob Ivey.
I see accents, okay. I'm happy to see that several of my students are here. It's a wonder what extra credit can do in these kind of situations. So I'd like to begin on January 8th, 1918. This is a few months after Woodrow Wilson asked Congress for the declaration of war, in his words, to make the world safe for democracy. On this day, President Woodrow Wilson unveiled his much-anticipated 14 points, a roadmap for peace while the war was still being fought on three continents. The core of the opening statement made clear the perceived purpose of this war. Quote, what we demand in this war is that the world be made fit and safe to live in, and particularly that it be made safe for every peace-loving nation, which, like our own, wishes to live its own life, determine its own institutions, be assured of justice and fair dealings by the other peoples of the world as against force and selfish aggression. Yet, it could easily be argued that the United States had, for nearly the last 50 years, done very little to assure the justice and fair dealing of a large segment of their population, the African American community. My talk today will attempt to give a brief overview of this quest for justice and fair dealing by the African American community in the United States during World War I, most notably their contributions to the war effort. Nearly 400,000 African Americans served in the Great War. Now, the vast majority of these, well over about 200,000, would serve largely as laborers, both in Europe and back in the United States in training camps. But as many as 42,000, nearly 11% of all blacks in the Army, would serve in combat. And of those, many would gain numerous honors and prestige. I would note, though, that it was this association with honor that drove much of the narrative for African-American troops to take part in the war. Early posters and propaganda target not only Americans as a whole, but also specific segments of the population, most notably African-Americans. According to historian Jennifer King, quote, official wartime propaganda sought to tap into the patriotism and racial pride of African-Americans to secure the enthusiastic support of this vital minority community. Posters and recruitment efforts during and after the war illustrated the history and importance of these black men and their contributions to not only the war, but the country. Examples include, this are colored fighters, as well as true sons of freedom, that depict the accomplishments of African Americans both at home and abroad. The deeds of the, quote, colored fighters are on full display, and the defeat of the Germans strikingly similar to many posters where whites are defeating the Germans as well. The place of Lincoln is not an unusual feature, as the Great Emancipator is typically acted as a historical connection to the promises of black liberation and participation in the war. This particular poster, coming from E.G. Renesch, I think is particularly fascinating. It depicts Lincoln holding really what is the Declaration of Independence, and yet it has Abraham Lincoln as the author, a slight misprint on this front, I'm sure. Key African-American figures are here, including on the left, we have Lieutenant Frank Dennison, commander of the All-African-American 8th Illinois, and on the right, Lieutenant Colonel Otis Duncan, who commanded the 8th Illinois to the war's conclusion. We also see cultural figures that connect to the social, artistic, and political past that are embodied in this piece, including on the left is Paul Laurence Dunbar, a very important poet within the African-American community who dies in 1906. And to the right, of course, is Frederick Douglass, who at that point, and who is still very much dead. We also see a quote and an image of Booker T. Washington, who says, "We have cleared the forest, reclaimed the land, and are building cities and great institutions." This is African-American economic gain, and on the line on the left, our children are being educated and will become useful citizens and a power in all affairs of life. We see similar imagery like this that very much connects to the rising image of African-Americans and their encouragement to take part in the war. These other two pieces by E.G. Renesch depict family waiting for their husbands slash father to return, and two sweethearts bidding farewell. Both are typical and actually rather conservative scenes, though both illustrate an attempt to normalize the view of African Americans going to war. It should be noted, though, as the story Jennifer Keene has pointed out, images like these are used later on in the war to sort of depict how African Americans are becoming a bit, quote, uppity, because they think they can have normal lives like this, and this terrifies many Southerners who will, well, treat them accordingly, as we will see. With this in mind, I think the war really illustrates a chance for black leadership to show their support for their country. Like little government action that actually been done to prevent the lynching, segregation, etc., which was embodied in the Jim Crow system. On the left, we have Emmett Scott, who's a former secretary of Booker T. Washington, the Tuskegee Institution. He served as a special assistant to the Secretary of War in charge of matters related to African Americans in the war. That's a mouthful. And then, of course, on the right, the incredibly famous author of The Souls of Black Folk, W.B. Du Bois, who actually wrote in his editorial Close Rank, quote, "Let us, while this war lasts, forget our special grievances and close our ranks shoulder to shoulder with our own white fellow citizens and allied nations that are fighting for democracy." Now, of course, this enthusiasm isn't universally felt within the African-American community. Chad Williams, in his book, Torchbearers of Democracy, gives, I think, a very insightful account, quote, "A black man in Harlem, when asked by the patrons of a neighborhood barbershop engaged in a vivid conversation about the war, if he planned to join the army, replied, quote, 'The Germans ain't done nothing to me, and if they have, I forgive them.' However, there are no lack of volunteers. And in fact, the number of volunteers and draftees are going to allow the military to create two combat units of African Americans, the 92nd and 93rd Division. The 93rd Division is going to consist almost exclusively of Black National Guard units from New York, Chicago, Washington, D.C., Cleveland, and the Massachusetts area. Of these included the 15th or the eventually the 369th Infantry Regiment from New York. The 15th Regiment, which we'll talk about in more detail in a second, faced its own hardships before even arriving in France. To finish its rush training, the Union was sent from New York City to Spartanburg, South Carolina. And in hearing that this unit of all blacks was coming to Spartanburg, South Carolina, the mayor of Spartanburg, South Carolina sent a very interesting note to the War Department saying, quote, "I'm sorry to learn that the 15th Regiment has been ordered here, for with their northern ideas about race equality, they'll probably expect to be treated like white men. I can say right here that they will not be treated as anything except Negroes. We will treat them exactly as we treat our resident neighbors. This thing is like a waving a red flag in the face of a bull. Something can't be done without trouble. We have asked Congressman Nichols to request the War Department not to send the soldiers here. You remember the trouble a couple weeks ago in Houston." The term Houston is important here, because a few months earlier, in July 1917, the 3rd Battalion of the Black 24th Infantry Regiment was ordered to Houston to guard the construction of a new training camp called Camp Logan, illustrated here. Not surprisingly, the unit, while they are in Houston, face a great deal of harassment within the Jim Crow South, not just from its citizens, but from the police, as well as fellow white soldiers. On August 23rd, two policemen arrest a black soldier for interfering in the arrest of a black woman. When a Corporal Charles Baltimore, a black military policeman with the battalion, requested information about the arrested soldier, he was beaten over the head by these police. Baltimore and his 11 other military police flee the scene, but they are fired at by the Houston police officers. Baltimore himself is eventually going to be captured by the Houston police. Now, rumors begin to circulate that Baltimore has not been captured, but has in fact been killed. Battalion commander, Major Neyland Snow, a white officer, attempts to discount the news, but at the same time collects to prevent any of these soldiers from avenging their dead comrade. But the situation soon grew out of hand. By the evening, rumors of a white mob coming to attack the camp gain traction, and soon around 100 soldiers grab their weapons and under the command of Sergeant Vita Henry, marched into Houston and began attacking police and civilians. In all, 20 people are killed, 2 black soldiers, 5 white police officers, and 13 civilians. The vast majority of the victims were white, and some reports stated that the soldiers specifically targeted whites over blacks. Now, frankly, the reason for this attack is unclear, okay? But it's unlikely that there is an elaborate conspiracy by the troops to go and attack the town that is brought forward in the later court-martial. But instead, it's probably a byproduct of the combined fear, tension, and misinformation that dominated this period. For example, there's a belief that the leader, Sergeant Henry, had this elaborate conspiracy, but in all likelihood, has been argued by some historians, Henry actually enjoyed his time in Houston and enjoyed his relationships with much of the African-American community they experienced there, and in some instances, some of the white community as well. But Henry himself, realizing the gravity of the situation once he returned to the camp after the evening, shot himself and committed suicide. In the aftermath of Houston, the 13th Battalion was transferred to New Mexico, and there 118 men were arrested, charged with murder and mutiny and court-martialed. 110 men were convicted, though all proclaimed their innocence, and in fact stated that no one could actually see who they were because it was, excuse the cliche, a dark and stormy night while they were in Houston. Despite this, many of the men who were tried were pressed to confess with the promise of leniency. Despite these promises, 28 men were sentenced to death, 68 men were sentenced to life in prison. Of these 28 death sentences, 10 were commuted by President Wilson, but on December 11, 1917, 13 of these individuals are executed before the case is even reviewed, or in fact, these soldiers had an opportunity to correspond and see their families. Should be noted that during this entire trial, the battalion's white officers were completely acquitted of any wrongdoing and received no repercussions for their role in this action. Now, Houston is an obvious indication of the racial tension that still and will continue to exist in the United States, even with the buildup of black troops being sent to Europe. Memory would act as a precursor to the Red Summer of 1919, and the continued racial tension that would haunt the U.S. for decades to come. But even the soldiers that made their way across the Atlantic to Europe would not escape the racism that remained an endemic component of the character of the United States and its military. And these are a set of black officers that we see here. While many of these black units would ship over the front with black officers, they were not treated with the same respect as their fellow white officers. One account between two is clear evidence of this continued prejudice. Quote, one day a colonel met a colored captain whom he thought he had seen before. Have I seen you somewhere? He asked. Yes, sir, replied the man. I was with you on the Mexican border in 1916. Captain French is my name, sir. Oh, I do remember, said the colonel. You are Sergeant French. No, sir, I am Captain French. Well, said the colonel as he walked away, if I forget and call you sergeant, don't mind. But the time in France is really a revelation. According to W.E. Du Bois, quote, never have I seen black folks so uplifted at the vision of a real democracy dawning on them in France. There's not a black soldier, but who is glad he went, glad to fight for France, quote, the only real white democracy. This realization of racial divisions back home was only exacerbated by the simple fact that once these black division arrived in France, they were not permitted to fight alongside their fellow Americans. But instead, as was alluded to in Dr. Taylor's talk, were put on loan to the French army, including being issued French military helmets and, in many instances, French military weapons. Note this was not entirely unheard of, but the 93rd Division was the only American division that served exclusively under the French during the war. However, within this 93rd Division, we have the 369th Infantry Regiment from New York, formerly the 15th Regiment, also known as the Black Rattlers. It would become probably one of the most famous African-American units in the war. According to historian Chad Williams, the regiment served for 191 days and ceded no ground to the German forces. They were the first American regiment to meet the Rhine River following the armistice and return to the United States national heroes. The unit became particularly famous for two reasons. One was their band leader, a gentleman by the name of James Reese Europe, who directed what was then seen as the best military band in the Army. James Europe soon became known on both sides of the Atlantic as the, quote, king of jazz. The other reason for the regiment's fame came from the actions of its soldiers. The most famous occurred on May 14th, 1918, when Needham Roberts and Henry Johnson, both severely wounded, fought off 24 German manned patrol. For their actions, Johnson and Roberts were awarded the Croix de Guerre, the Cross of War, and were the first Americans of any color to receive this award. In a communique, General Pershing said, and it's quoted here on the corner of this, poster, the colored man is eager to show his mettle and do his bit. By the conclusion of the war, 171 men of the 369th were awarded either the Legion of Honor or the Croix de Guerre, and the unit itself received the Regimental Croix de Guerre by the war's end. These honors, along with their actions in the field, that led the French to call these men the Men of Bronze, and it led the Germans to call them by probably the most famous name they're associated with, the Harlem Hellfighters. Sadly, the success of the Hellfighters was not felt by their brothers in arms in the 92nd Division. Though they fought bravely, they were scapegoated for the American Expeditionary Force's failures in the Argonne in 1918, and five of their black officers were court-martialed, with a white officer, Major J. Merrill of 368 1st Battalion, writing to his superiors, quote, without my presence or that of any other white officer right on the firing line, I was absolutely positive that not a single colored officer would have advanced with his men. The cowardice showed by the men was abject. However, the Men of Bronze do receive massive ovation when they do eventually return home in February 1918. 3,000 veterans of the 369th Regiment were met by some 250,000 spectators as they made their way from 5th Avenue and 23rd Street to 145th and Lenox. towards the end of what is today the Harlem River and along Malcolm X Boulevard. Even W.B. Du Bois was hopeful at the end of this war and this mass showing of support by these men, saying in the crisis, quote, we returned fighting, made way for democracy. We saved it in France, and by the great Jehovah, we will save it in the United States of America, or know the reason why. Sadly, this sentiment does not last long. By the summer of 1919, there is a series of race riots giving the name Red Summer, where in many instances, African-American men are killed en masse, and in some instances, the men who served on the Western Front are lynched. In some instances, even while they are in uniform. But the legacy of the African-American soldiers who fought in the Great War has begun to be fully realized. At least a dozen books in the last 10 years have been written to attempt to track the contributions of Black troops. Soldiers like Henry Johnson, the first to receive the Croix de Guerre, never received a single military honor from the United States while he is alive. Here's a picture of him with the Croix de Guerre proudly on his vest, but never received another single honor from the United States. It will be long after his death in 1996, where he will receive the Purple Heart, and then the Distinguished Service Cross in 2002. And then posthumously in 2015, led by a long petition process put forward by Senator Chuck Schumer, Sergeant Henry Johnson was awarded the Medal of Honor, the scene depicted here. So in the end, just as World War I was not the war to end all wars, it did not remove the shadow of Jim Crow, despite the shine of the Croix de Guerre. But perhaps commemorations like these can continue to allow these Americans to act as an example of a nation that continues to embody the ideals of justice and fair dealing for all people, Black, white, or otherwise. Thank you.
How about another big round of applause for our panel here? Time for just a few questions for our presenters, if anybody would have one. Or... Yes, sir.
I always thought that Wilson was the one that wanted the troops under American leadership so that he could influence the terms of after the war. And it was brought up today that it wasn't Wilson that was doing that.
Well, General Pershing is a man on the spot. Definitely did not want the United States Army to be led by foreigners. So this would have been a major blow, of course, a blow to him and others. But he and President Wilson were in complete accord on that, that there would be a separate American army with a separate section of the front. So, and of course, being at the negotiating table at the end of the war certainly is a fact, too. So, thank you. Somebody else. Yes, sir.
There was there's some comments that have been made in the past that there was some sentiment in favor of the Germans in World War One or before, you know, the Great War, whatever you call it back then. Would you care to comment on that? Was there in fact that I had heard that someone made a comment one time in a lecture that there was also the possibility that they would come in on the side of the Germans or the Central Powers. I've never seen anything beyond that. Someone makes
that a crack at that one?
The likelihood of the United States going to war with Germany, I think, is near impossible. Part of it is because of the longstanding diplomatic ties that the United States had with both France and Britain. I think the best hope that the Germans could have is that the United States would remain outside the war. And in fact, even those individuals who you would consider themselves German sympathizers, they aren't necessarily individuals who are calling for joining the war on the side of the United States. They're joining the side of Britain, but instead they're calling for staying out of the war and not assisting Great Britain and France during this process. So there may be some fringe elements that believe that's a possibility, but if you're talking about the general consensus, even within the German population, the very nationalistic German section of the German population, it's entirely unlikely that would actually even be a possibility.
And remember, too, that the British, as Dr. Allen told us, controlled a lot of the flow of information coming from Europe through those neutral telephone cables. So Britain, in the propaganda war, painting the Germans as the evil Huns, the spike helmets, who supposedly, when they invaded little Belgium, raped nuns and baited babies and did all sorts of terrible things. So it would have been, again, very difficult. Though, if you were an American of German descent, you know, it was hard to not have some sympathy for the bottom. So it's a good point. Yes, ma'am.
So we weren't prepared for World War I and we weren't prepared for World War II.
Correct.
So we were never prepared, so I guess they just started getting prepared after this.
Well, one of the things that the United States has always counted on, there are two large oceans between us and the rest of the world. Our neighbors are Canada, who are just like us, except the folks in Quebec, and the folks in Mexico, who the United States would attack twice. So we had the luxury for a good chunk of our history of not needing a together prepared military establishment. World War II showed those days were over. And don't get me wrong, defense budgets go up and go down. When we went into Iraq, American soldiers did not have properly armored Humvees to drive in. There were shortages of other types of equipment. So that is sadly part of the story. So it's a very good point.
There's an interesting little story of in April 1917, after the war begins, that British and French liaisons from the American embassy go to the War Department, and they say, how much ammunition based on your operations? And the U.S. Army officials come back and say, based on our current military operations, we have 2 years' worth of supplies on hand in our warehouses and our military bases across the country. And the British and French are, this is a massive amount of stuff. Obviously, if they're producing all these weapons, they have all this stuff for themselves. And so they get a report, paper reports of all the details. And the British come back the final next day and say, you know, we really love you, you like our cousins, but this is about 2 weeks' worth of combat operations on the Western Front, and you will have nothing left. But the Americans said, well, based on our operations fighting against, well, in the Philippines and in Nicaragua and in Haiti and elsewhere, our small little borders, we have plenty of supplies, and that's how backwards things were. World War II, though, was a little different. By 1940, the National Service Act to start gearing up to the war eventually makes us less backwards than it is in the First World War. There's also the little fact that the last Civil War active soldier, he'd been a drummer boy at Shiloh, had retired. His name's Colonel Clem. He had retired in 1909 from active military service. So the U.S. military itself was unprepared for this war, even by any model.
And General Pershing spent Civil War battles. He thought that would help him command the Western Front. Somebody else have time for one more? Going? Well, ladies and gentlemen, thank you. Frank, at the buzzer.
I hesitate. I was thinking back to this aspect of wiretapping and how it was just politically incorrect even then, definitely during World War II. And then trying to recall who is the, Secretary of Defense or Marquette Roosevelt. Gentlemen do not read other gentlemen's mail.
Well, I guess there's a shortage of gentlemen in the world. you know, information, power, national survival is at stake. I mean, issues of war peace. So, ever since, I suppose, in the caveman era, when one fellow had a particularly sharp sense of hearing, he could pick up things. So, now, in some ways, we've come a long way since 1917. In other ways, it's back to the future. Well, ladies and gentlemen, again, thank you very much. Thanks to the Evans. evening. There are still a few donuts back there. We still have a few Army History magazines. You see one laying around, pick it up, take it home. It's free. Your tax dollars paid for it. And I hope to see you again soon. Thank you very much. Good night.
Thank you.
That's cool.